After witnessing that amazing jump, it is absolutely my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, 50-year U.S. Olympic record holder in the long jump and humanitarian, Mr. Bob Beamon. Since jumping his way into the record books at the 1968 Mexico City Olympic Games by shattering the long jump record, Mr. Beamon has used his voice and visibility to improve the communities of which he is a part, and specifically to encourage and support youth in a number of ways. Born in South Jamaica, Queens, New York, Mr. Beamon used his athletic prowess to his advantage, and by the time he entered the 1968 Olympic Games, he had 22 wins on his resume, including the 1965 National High School Triple and High Jump and the 1967 AAU Long Jump Championship, in addition to holding the New York State record. Mr. Beamon remains active in the Olympic movement and is a member of the National Track and Field Hall of Fame, the U.S. Olympic Hall of Fame, the USA Track and Field Hall of Fame, and was recently appointed as the Global Ambassador to Special Olympics. He was also selected as one of ESPN's top 100 athletes of the 20th century. As a lifelong learner, Mr. Beamon went back to college after his career in sports and now holds a bachelor's degree in sociology from Adelphi University, where he later received an honorary doctorate. As the Deputy Commissioner of Parks in Miami-Dade County, Mr. Beamon, along with actor Arnold Schwarzenegger, organized the South Florida Inner City Games for at-risk kids. In 1997, he developed the Bob Beamon Organization for Youth, which has raised over $2 million for disadvantaged scholar athletes. Further, he collaborates with several organizations to facilitate scholarship fairs in Central Florida, where more than 35 colleges and universities award over $10 million in scholarships to qualified high school seniors. In addition to spending time as an inspirational speaker, Mr. Beamon published his autobiography, The Man Who Could Fly, The Bob Beamon Story, developed his own motivational program for youth, created a line of apparel, and operates his own corporation, Bob Beamon Communications, Inc., in Las Vegas, Nevada, where he now lives with his wife, Rhonda. And as a diabetic, he also continues to promote a healthy lifestyle. While his record-setting jump is quite amazing, and his list of accolades is quite impressive, Mr. Beamon's record of service, his humanitarianism, is what further solidifies his place as a role model. And while I know that the word Beamonesque has been traditionally reserved for extraordinary sports achievements, I'd like to use it to describe the type of servant leadership that we all should emulate, a Beamonesque commitment to serving others. I am impressed and appreciative of your lifetime of dedicated service and leadership, Mr. Beamon. And as I prepare to invite you to deliver your remarks, I'd like to first ask that you please join our board chairman, Bill King, and me for a special recognition. Mr. Beamon, you have consistently used your platform as a force to help and serve others, and you are truly an extraordinary example of the servant leadership that we strive to cultivate in our students. For your Beamonesque achievements in learning, service, and leadership, I'd like to recognize you as a member of the Eureka College President Servant Leader Hall of Honor. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in congratulating and welcoming our 2018 commencement speaker, Mr. Bob Beamon.
Yeah, I was watching this piece here on the jump, and that's a a younger Bob Beeman, but I do look a lot better today, don't I? Greetings, Eureka College class of 2018. I know today you do not really want to spend your day listening to me. You are waiting for that magic moment when your name is called as you walk across the stage, and you do not do anything, I will not do anything to delay that. So I will be brief. I'm going to share with you just three life lessons that I have learned. In the end, I hope something that I say resonates with you. Dr. Seuss said, "You have brains in your head and you have feet in your shoes. You can steer yourself any direction you choose." There is a book about my life entitled The Man Who Could Fly, and a large focus on the book is my life before the Olympics and before I had direction. I learned a lot about my life from writing the book. I was a cocky kid. I mean a real cocky kid. From the projects of New York. And I was proud of the fact that I could curse, smoke, drink, and hang with the best of them. I sang backup during street corner doo-wops session. Some of you may not know what doo-wops is, but your parents or grandparents may. That one got me, but anyway. For most of you, as I said, you do not know what doo-wops were. But I was proud to be a part of a street gang called the Frenchmen. However, I could not read or write a simple sentence. I did not come from a traditional household. For a long time, as I grew up, in the streets were my family. An arrest as a teenager for a mistaken identity, for murder, that could have steered my life in a different direction. But my incredible grandmother had another direction for my life instead of jail. I was released from the courts to my grandmother, and I was sent to an alternative school at PS 600. And I'm going to say to you, an alternative school was not easy. I found that I was at least steering myself in a direction, a new direction. I entered and won the gold medal at the Junior Olympics, jumping 24 feet, 1 inch, and I had my beautiful picture in the paper. But you know, my family had a nonchalant attitude about it. But that didn't burst my bubble. I was proud of myself. I wanted to fly. I wanted to see how high I could go. I wanted to go back now to regular school. We took the newspaper article to Jamaica High School, where I met Coach Ellis, who became very interested and told me, "I can only show you the way, and it is up to you to go there." I love being an athlete. I just wanted to train hard and do something special in my life. I was named All-American in track and field, All-City honorable mention basketball. In 1964, I was ranked 10th among all high school long jumpers in the United States. Something very interesting happened. My coach, Larry Ellis, brought some Olympians to the high school. Some brief introduction: long jump champion Ralph Boston and champion sprinter Wilma Rudolph entered the gym. I knew from that moment, and I saw and heard these great athletes speak, I wanted to be one of them. From that moment on, I started to prepare myself for the 1968 Olympics. At this time, I knew the direction I wanted to steer my life. Success is not the key to happiness. Happiness is the key to success. If you love what you're doing, you will be successful. I'm now going to college now. I'm going to be an Olympian. How did I know I would be a success? Because I love what I was doing. I ran in the heat. I ran in the rain. I ran in the snow. It did not matter what weather I was running in. I ran when I was hurt. I ran when I was exhausted. I ran when I didn't feel well. I ran for a dream that I was going to be someone special. In 1965 now, I was ranked second in the long jump, jumping 25 feet. Now, this is high school. 25 feet. That's kind of a long ways, isn't it? 25 feet, 3 inches. Now, while at El Paso College, every morning you could see me running out on the barrens and the foothills, training hard. Time was short to prepare for the 1968 Olympics. It seemed to be passing slowly. I am not going to tell you that it was easy just because I loved it. I found myself at a long jump competition along beside my great hero, Ralph Boston, and the Los Angeles high school kid, Jerry Proctor. Just in a flash, Proctor had out jumped much further than me or Ralph Boston. Wow. That was my wake-up call. I mean, how could a high school kid beat me? How did I deal with the fact that he had beat also my great champion, Ralph Boston? I wasn't concerned. I was really not concerned about Mr. Boston. I was starting to concern about my performance. I promised myself that I would never be beaten again because of overconfidence. I searched my soul and had to admit to myself that I had taken this high school kid, Jerry Proctor, seriously. From then on, when I entered the competition, I would concentrate and visualize my own performance. I would say a prayer before every jump. I would not be concerned about or listen to what other persons might or might not do or say. Then that wonderful afternoon, the NC2A finals. I was favored in the triple jump and the long jump. And I had to jump against the superstar Calvin Hill, who was favored in the triple jump. And his son is the great Grant Hill now. I did not focus on Calvin, though instead I remained quiet. I remained quiet. Very, very quiet, and went off by myself before the jump. I closed my eyes and I saw myself running down the runway, leaping off the board, jumping 1, 2, 3 in the sand pit. And when my name was called, I focused inwardly and my body seemed to be on automatic, as if in playback of my previous mental performance. When it came time for the long jump, I would follow the same cadence in my mind. Relax, focus, pray. When the sand settled, I had literally flown over the pit. My work on the sprints had paid off, and I had perfected the rhythm of the speed that I needed to maximize the takeoff of my runway. I used my upper body and arms in synchronization with the vibration of the drums playing in my head. What appeared on the outside was like an aerodynamic design, human taking off and landing. And the very next day, the NC2A triple jump, long jump champion read in the papers, Bob Beamon won. After I won, I said, this is not a time to relax. This was the time to work harder. I could smell the aroma of the Olympics. I could taste the flavor of winning. I dreamed of trading Olympic pins, collecting sponsors' giveaways, and sporting the official Olympic warm-up. These were the dreams that I had not dared to dream before. But I was loving the journey to success. The drum major instinct, a desire to be out front, the desire to lead the parade. But the drum major instinct for something, the drum major instinct for justice, the drum major instinct for peace, and the drum major for righteousness. I had heard this speech from Dr. Martin Luther King regarding the drum major instinct. And of course, I'm not sure that I did not take it all the way that he meant it. But it stuck in my heart and conscience. Track and field, especially the long jump, was not a team sport. I was used to being out front. I was used to being alone, forging my own path. Wow. And besides, being a track athlete was like being a rock star. But in the 1960s was a different time. Jack Olson, who was writing a series on the black athletes for Sports Illustrated, wrote that I was naive because I asked questions like, can you explain something to me? How can people hate one another? Why is it that white people are so prejudiced against colored people? Was it naive to question the venom that poisoned the people's hearts and minds? I don't think so. I wanted to know why I had to cross a picket line in New York City for a track meet, my hometown, in order to compete. You know why? Because the New York Athletic Club didn't admit blacks, Jews, or Hispanics. But each year they profited big time from their sponsored meets and consisted of black athletes competing. The decision to cross the picket line made college, my college administration, happy. They were counting on us to bring the championship back to El Paso. But the decision was nothing compared to the next one that I had to make. My next meet was between Utah State and Brigham Young University. Brigham Young University was a Mormon school. The Book of Mormons castigate the black race as an inferior and descendants from the devil. Nine of us went to the administration and told them that we were definitely not going to compete in Utah. The answer was simple. If you boycott Utah, your scholarships will be history. It was a major deal. News organizations from all over the world, including the New York Times, reported the incident. Thus, I lost my scholarship. I lost it. I was not going to lose my dream because I lost my scholarship. I continued training for Mexico City. Being Olympian was not going to be a dream deferred. Not for me. Beaminess is found in the dictionary. Boy, I'm cool, baby. Doing something completely unexpected and being completely amazing, coming out of nowhere with great excellence involved. As I close, graduates, today, Beaminess life is what I wish for you. If I had quit, where would I be now? If I had not been inspired by so many wonderful people, where would I be now? Maybe you will find something in my words, that will inspire you. I hope that each and every day, you will continue to find inspiration in living, and I'm saying living, living and giving. I am the man who can fly, and I'm still flying. Go into the world and do well. But more importantly, go into the world and do good. I love you. I congratulate you from the bottom of my heart, and God bless you. Thank you.